So here we have this course variable set to Python programming. As I told you before, whenever you work with text, you should surround your text with quotes. You can either use double quotes or single quotes. That's more of a personal preference, but quite often we use double quotes. We also have triple quotes, and we use them to format a long string. For example, if you have, let's say, a variable message, that is the message we want to include in the body of an email, you can use triple quotes to format it like this. Hi, John. This is Mosh from codewithmosh.com, blah, blah, blah. So that's when we use triple quotes. Now, we don't need this in this lecture, so delete. Let me show you a few useful things you can do with strings. First of all, we have this built-in function in Python for getting the length of strings. What is a function? A function is basically a reusable piece of code that carries out a task. As a metaphor, think of the remote control of your TV. On this remote control, you have buttons for different functions, like turn on, turn off, change the channel, and so on. These are the built-in functions in your TV. In Python and many other programming languages, we have the exact same concept. So we have functions that are built into the language and the platform. You can reuse these functions to perform various tasks. So here we can use the built-in len function to get the length of a string, which means the number of characters in that string. Now, whenever you want to use a function, you should use parentheses. Now we say we're calling this function, which basically means we're using this function. Now, some functions take additional data, which we refer to as arguments. These arguments are inputs to these functions. So this len function takes an input or an argument. Here we pass our course variable, and this will return the number of characters in this string. So let's print that and see what we get. Run the program. We get 18 because we have 18 characters here. Let's look at another example. If you want to get access to a specific character in this string, you use the square bracket notation. So here we add course, square brackets. To get the first character, you use the index 0. So in Python, like many other languages, strings are 0 indexed, which means the index of the first character or the first element is 0. So now when we print this, we'll get P, okay? Now you can also use a negative index, like minus 1. What does that mean? Well, if 0 represents the first character here, what do you think negative 1 represents? That takes us back to the end of the string. So that returns the first character from the end of the string. Let's run this program. You will see we'll get G. There you go. Using a similar syntax, you can slice strings. Let me show you. So I'm going to duplicate this line and remove negative 1. Now let's say we want to extract the first 3 characters in this string. So here we need 2 indexes. The start index, colon, the end index. So this will return a new string that contains the first 3 characters in this course variable. That will be P, Y, and T. So the index of these characters are 0, 1, and 2. So that means the character at the end index is not included, okay? Let's run the program and make sure we get the right result. There you go, P, Y, T. Now, what if we don't include the end index? What do you think we're going to get? It's common sense. We start from index 0 and go all the way to the end of the string. So this will return a new string that is exactly the same as the original string. Let's take a look. So we get Python programming. Now, what if we don't include the start index, but include the end index? What do you think we're going to get? Once again, it's common sense. So by default, Python will put 0 here, so it will start from the beginning of the string. So when I run this program, we should get PYT one more time. There you go. And finally, as the last example, if we don't include the start and the end index, This will return a copy of the original string. Let's look at this. So we get Python programming. Now, you don't have to memorize any of these. Just remember, we use the len function to get the length of a string. We use bracket notation to get access to a specific element or a specific character. And we use this notation to slice a string. So we have this string here, Python programming. Now, let's say we want to put a double quote in the middle of this string. There is a problem here. Python interpreter sees this second string as the end of the string. So the rest of the code is meaningless and invalid. How do we solve this problem? Well, there are two ways. One way is to use single quotes for our string, and then we can use a double quote in the middle of the string. But what if for whatever reason, perhaps for being consistent in our code, we decided to use double quotes? How can we add another double quote in the middle of this string? Well, we can prefix this with a backslash. Backslash in Python strings is a special character. We have a jargon for that called escape character. We use it to escape the character after. Let me show you what I mean. So let's print this course and run this program. What's going on here? We don't have the backslash because we use that to escape this double quote and basically display it here. So backslash is an escape character and backslash double quote is an escape sequence. In Python strings, we have a few other escape sequences that you should be aware of. Let me show you. So in Python, we use a hash sign to indicate a comment. A comment is like additional note that we add to our program. It's not executed by Python interpreter, okay? So here are the escape sequences. You have seen backslash double quote. We also have backslash single quote. So we can use that to add a single quote here. Let's run the program. Here it is, beautiful. We also have double backslash. So if you want to include a backslash in your strings, you should prefix it with another backslash. Let me show you. So when we run this, we get Python one backslash programming. And finally, we have backslash n, which is short for new line. So now if I add a backslash n here, see what we get. We get a new line after Python, so programming will end up on the second line. So these are the escape sequences in Python. Here we have two variables, first and last. Let's say we want to print my full name on the console. So we can define another variable, full, set it to first, then concatenate it with a space, and one more time concatenate it with last. Now when we print full, we get my full name on the console. Beautiful. Now this approach of using concatenation to build a string is okay, but there is a better and newer approach. We can use formatted strings. So here we can set full to this string and prefix it with an F, which can be lowercase or uppercase. This formatted string doesn't have a constant value like these two strings here. It's actually an expression that will be evaluated at runtime. So here we want to add our first name. We use curly braces to print the value of the first variable. After that, we add a space, and then we add curly braces one more time to print the last name. So at runtime, this expression will be evaluated. What we have in between curly braces will be replaced at runtime. Now let's run this program one more time. We get the exact same result. Just be aware that you can put any valid expressions in between curly braces. So earlier you learned about the built-in len function. We can call len here to get the length of this string. Let's run this program one more time, so we get 4. We can also replace last with an expression like this, 2 plus 2. Let's run this program, we get 4 and 4. So, when using formatted strings, you can put any valid expressions in between curly braces. In this lecture, we're going to look at a few useful functions available to work with strings. So earlier you learned about this built-in len function. This function is general purpose, so it's not limited to strings. Later, I will show you how to use this function with other kind of objects. But in Python, we have quite a few functions that are specific to strings. Let me show you. So here, if we type course dot, see, all these are functions available on strings. Now, in precise terms, we refer to these functions as methods. This is a term in object-oriented programming that you will learn about later in the course. For now, what I want you to take away is that everything in Python is an object, and objects have functions we call methods that we can access using the dot notation. So here, course is an object. We use the dot notation to access its functions, or more accurately, methods. Let's take a look at a few of these methods. We have upper to convert a string to uppercase. Now let's print this and run the program. Here's what we get. Beautiful. Now note that the methods that you call here return a new string, so the original string is not affected. Let me show you. So print course, run the program one more time. Look, this is our original string, right? So course.upper returns a new string, a new value. We can store it in a variable like course, underline capital, like this. Now, to keep this demo simple and consistent, I'm going to revert this back and use a print statement. We also have the lower method to convert a string to lowercase. We also have title, which will capitalize the first letter of every word. So if our string was like this, when we call the title method, we get Python programming as you see here, okay? Another useful method is strip, and we use it to trim any white space at the beginning or end of a string. This is particularly useful when we receive input from the user. Let me show you. So let's imagine the user entered a couple of white spaces at the beginning of the string. When we call course.strip, those white spaces will be removed. Take a look. So note that in the first three examples, we have those white spaces, but in the last one, it is removed. So strip removes the white space from both the beginning and end of a string. We also have lstrip, which is short for left strip, and rstrip, which is short for right strip. So it will remove the white space from the end of a string. If you want to get the index of a character or a sequence of characters in your string, you should use the find method. Let me show you. So course.find. So as an argument here, we pass another string. We can pass a character or a series of characters. Let's find the index of pro. Run the program. So the index of pro is 9. So if you start from 0 here all the way to 9, this is the index of pro. Okay? Now, as I told you before, Python is a case-sensitive language. So if I pass a capital P here, obviously we don't have these exact characters in our string. So let's see what we get. We get negative 1. That means this string was not found in the original string. Another useful method is replace. So we call replace. With this, we can replace a character or a sequence of characters with something else. So let's say we want to replace all lowercase p's with j. With this, we get Jython programming, whatever that means. And finally, if you want to check for the existence of a character or a sequence of characters in your string, you can use the in operator. Let me show you. So print, rewrite an expression like this, pro in course. So this is an expression. As I told you before, an expression is a piece of code that produces a value. So this expression checks to see if we have pro in course. The difference between this expression and calling the find method is that the find method returns the index of these characters in our string. Whereas this expression returns a Boolean, so it's a true or false. Let me show you. So run the program, we get the Boolean true. And finally, we have the not operator, and we use that to see if our string does not contain a character or a sequence of characters. So let's change this to Swift, not in course. When this expression is evaluated, what do you think we're going to get? Well, we don't have Swift in this string, so not in will return true. Let's take a look. There you go. So these are the useful string methods. Next, we'll look at numbers. Hi guys, thank you for watching this tutorial. My name is Mosh Hamadani, and I have tons of tutorials like this for you on my channel. So be sure to subscribe, and also please like and share this video. If you want to learn Python properly from scratch with depth, I have a comprehensive Python tutorial for you. The link is below this video, so click the link to get started. Thank you and have a fantastic day.